Hello. It's still, I feel like coming back home, actually, and the students sitting in the back in particular. So, like, you know, the usual environment. I think the lecture today is quite, I think it's quite casual. So if you have questions along the way, let me know. Hopefully, like, you'll learn something, you know. I was joking with my team earlier because I went out for lunch, right, that, hey, what are you doing this afternoon? I'm giving a talk at SUTD on Race to Zero. And then we were joking, like, is it walk to zero? Is it run to zero? Is it crawl to zero? You know, we're kind of like, we want to race to zero, but I think we try. But at the moment, you know, getting to that number or like this round thing is really difficult, you know, to get there. So let's kind of see how we're going, what we're doing. And it's a lot of topic to cover today. I think I can summarize it into four different elements that you should get out. So you should understand a little bit more about energy, water, and then waste, and a little bit about embodied carbon, not carbon per se, because I think people talk a lot about carbon already, right? So today, I'm touch upon embodied carbon, which might be a term that you know, but not really know, because it's a new thing in Singapore, and they call it whole life carbon. That's a term that people use in Singapore. Need to turn on. There you go. Okay. So I think, like, talks about, you know, Atelier 10, I think, like, Peter already gave a really good introduction. Thank you so much. We're well known to do things that are invincible to the point that we have a book named Invincible Architecture. So what we do in general is we do help, you know, architects, you know, engineers, so we're environmental design consultant, right? Myself, I actually graduated from Harvard, and then I joined the company 15 years ago, and here I am in Singapore. So I've been working in New York office, the Bangkok office, and then eventually opened Singapore in 2014. So here we are. And the reason why I came here was also because of Jewel. So we catch upon, I think, at the end trail of Gardens by the Bay finished 2012, and then Jewel's construction start around that time. So that's why we established the Singapore office, and here we are today, you know, working with all the iconic project around Singapore. But I think mainly we try to make sure that, you know, we make a positive influence on the project. So if we go into a project, right, the first thing normally, I mean, my business operation manager is actually joining me today, that we would get the question from the client is, we want to do green map, you know, we want to do green map platinum, we want to do SLE, and then if we do only that, then we are not driving the market, we're not transforming the market. So when we go into a project, we really want to go in and add value and make sure that we make positive difference at the end, you know, and think of innovation, what kind of things we can do in a project. So that's kind of how we are. If you ever come down to Chinatown, want to visit the office, we actually have one SUTD grad, Shigan, who's one of my students actually from here, in the office. So we don't mind, you know, have a chat with you. Or if you're like, can I go into consulting? We don't mind talking to you as well. So that's who we are. But if you don't know us, so these projects I'm sure you've seen before. This is our project, you know, all the iconic project. That picture in particular actually was taken last night, because my London and New York team is in town this week, so I took them out to Gardens by the Bay last night. It was just quite nice, you know, it's a nice, good, like, comfort night to walk around. And, of course, Jewel, the big one that you see. So these are, like, our iconic projects. So then getting back to the topic of race, you know, raising to zero, like, what are we doing? What are we running? You know, we're not Formula One. We're trying to get there. It's just a really simple number, which is zero, right? But so difficult to get there. And even me, it's like my everyday life. It's like people ask, like, how do you get there? What is a roadmap? What is your goal? You know, so what is it exactly? So if you don't know, the definition actually comes from the UN, you know, and it's a goal to hit by 2030 in a nutshell. That's basically it. And then mostly the term itself is about carbon. So it ties with energy, of course, but not so much like on other stuff that we'll touch upon today, like water, waste. Embodied energy is part of it. So that's kind of mainly is energy and embodied energy is part of this like carbon, right? So this is like the where it comes from in terms of the term, but it has become kind of like the tagline, you know, we will join the race to zero. So that's kind of like the tagline that I've seen. And this one, I think only in the past 2 years that it has like surfaced. But lately in the industry, what I have to say is every meeting that I go to, if I hear the word net zero goal, we're going to be the first net zero something one more time. Like I, to the point that I'm telling the client now that, you know, I just came out from another meeting that the client's also like, I'm going to be the first net zero something, you know. And then I had to tell the client that someone needs to be the first, but you're probably not going to be the first, and you're not going to be the first either, you know? So it's more like, what are you going to do beyond that? So that is a good question to ask, and what is unique about the project that is innovative enough? So it's a good to know for zero, but I think sometimes you need to push beyond, like, you know, the lecture series, right? Design beyond zero. And we'll touch upon that toward, like, the end of the lecture. Then come this. Probably you've seen this during the COVID, the whole COVID thing, right? COP26 happened. And the outcome of this, I think the term that, or like the summary that people remember the most is the 1.5 degree. That's kind of like the big summary, you know, there's more to it than that. But that's kind of the biggest one. And I just want to point it out, like, why is it so big? And why is the goal really important to get there? So just to do the quick commit, this one I got, you know, from my research, it's like 1.5 degree difference. The future, you know, you could go to 2, you could go to 3. That's kind of where we are. And that's why in Singapore right now, all the design are gearing also toward like cooler Singapore is another term that you will hear a lot when you graduate and get into the field. But with just 1.5 degree, here's a difference. So 1.5 degree, right, it could affect, you know, how we live. And imagine if you double that. So 1.5, double to 3, that's like, you look at the magnitude of order, it's from 4% to 40%. That's a lot of effects, you know, in terms of habitats. So something to think along, like why we are doing this, why we are getting to zero, why we're trying to make the climate change better now that the key term is now as well. If you really think about it, this one was also coming out from lunch today, quite interesting lunch. So we were talking like, oh, okay, if the target is 2030, right? Most of the project, how long do you think it takes to do from the student? 5 years, 7 years, if you think, right? Big project would be 7, small, medium would be like 3 to 5. So today is 2022. By the time I'm hitting my ground is 2023 plus 7, I'm going to get to 2030, you know, eventually. So to finish my project in 2030, to do this zero thing is like today, right, to hit that goal. So that's why it's quite important. So a lot of industry, that's why like the time is now and everyone is in it, all the big tech company are in it as well, you know. So this, because the funny part about all of this company, right, they're like, I'm going to get into metaverse, you know, everything's going to be digital, everything's going to be transformative. But then when they do that, they have to build data center. So when you build data center, you use a lot of energy. And then at the same time, your corporate goal is like, I'm not going to get to net zero. So it's like, you know, going against each other. So the build is built. And then the corporate is like, I don't care how much you build, I'm going to get to zero. So it's like a two separate trend going on, something to watch out. Then comes the first category that we'll touch upon for like about 5 to 10 minutes, which is on energy and carbon, right? This chart, interesting enough, since I joined Atelier 10, I've seen it. So that's like way back in 2007, which is 15 years ago. To date, nothing changed. The progression, similar. What changed is actually where I am on this chart. So when I first joined the company as an architecture student grad, most of the things that I can do back then are like more on the climate design, building envelope, you know, kind of end. Which in your studio, you know, you do all this stimulation, right? That to get like solar load reduction, daylight stimulation, you're nodding. So that's good. I see people nodding. That's always good that you learn something and you do something. So all of the high performance design, you know, is way back in, I think like about 15 years ago, right? And then comes more like in terms of performance. So district cooling, chiller, LED, you know, so that's like about 10 years ago. It's kind of the trend, right? 10 years ago, it's like, I'm going to like doing all of this. And then now, if you ask me, everyone's talking about renewable. You know, what can I do to get a better renewable energy? What type of renewable energy on site I can do? Which is very difficult because Singapore, the site that you have is very tiny and I need to go up and my roof will be like very tiny at the top. You know, so it's really difficult to harvest and how much can you get out from the vertical PV? Not so much. You know, so that's quite a challenge, right, in Singapore. And then to get to carbon neutral in Singapore, and I'll repeat it later again, it's difficult because the definition now, you can have on-site renewable, not a problem. That will reduce your energy use to a certain level. But to get to carbon neutral, you need to actually get the Singapore renewable energy, meaning production in Singapore. So that's a difficult part because imagine you don't have a lot of land. And a lot of people will, you know, use up all of this off-site already, right? From outside, from your like, let's say SUTD has a certain capacity of renewable energy to produce on-site, right? And then you need to get some more from off-site to get to your zero. So off-site will be used by some other people as well. So that's why it's difficult to get all of this off-site eventually, I think in 5 to 7 years. Similarly to what I told you before, most of my client will say, oh, we'll get it offsite somewhere. And then me, because I work on a lot of big projects, right? I kind of know that this client already purchased it like 5 years ahead of you, you know, and that client already purchased it too. So it's kind of knowing the market, how much availability. That's why, like, me personally, I'm worried. And then I hope that eventually Singapore will open up the market to the region. That will be better because like Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam has, you know, tons and abundance of land also for all of this renewable energy that they can use. So then the other term you should know, and this one comes from the World Green Building Council, Advancing Net Zero, so ANZ or ANZ, depends on how you say it. This one is quite good, and actually I haven't gone back to see it since 2018. I think that was the last time when I kind of, you know, look up the definition, but because of today's lecture, right, I went back, and there's a lot of update to it. So this slide, actually, if you look at the data at the bottom, it's the version one, it's the original version from 2018. So this is the original goal that we're trying to get to this net zero building, if my pointers work. Yes. So all the new building must operate, you know, in a net zero carbon world by 2030, right? So that's kind of like the key target. Then, since then, nothing published much. But then when I go back again today, what's quite interesting is now the roadmap, they have a more established roadmap because before when you go on to this type of website, right, they will say like, here's a goal, but not really the methodology or how do you get there. So now, if you look at this roadmap, it's not that different from what I showed you before, right? That Atelier 10 has drawn that diagram earlier. It's the same procedure. The only thing that got added is embodied energy that we'll talk about in a bit too. Then, you know, it's kind of adding a little bit more, and I think this term, whole life carbon, is important for you to know because this one is the next big thing in Singapore. So if you want to get into the next big wave, you know, of like the advance in terms of knowledge, that's kind of the one that even for Atelier 10, we just have a new staff joining us from San Francisco, who's our embodied energy expert, actually. So even that when she first moved here, she has done this work for 2 to 3 years before in US. But when she moved to Singapore, then, you know, she's starting to realize that, oh, actually, the database here is not that great. So that's a problem, is also the database in the market to get the embodied carbon calculation work. So Singapore still have that problems. Then it's quite interesting to see this chart, actually, because to get to this race to zero thing, right, every country around the world now, you know, have joined force and then established their own pathway in a different way. So I kind of look around, okay, starting from, of course, like Singapore. So Singapore, I think that the key term that we hear again and again is green map platinum, of course, and then SLE. So now platinum is not a mandatory anymore for all the government project. It's super low energy or SLE, or even zero building. So net zero building is another one that you will hear. To say it, you might be like, I heard it before, so simple. But to get to SLE properly through green map process is a very difficult thing to do. Because the energy saving, you need to achieve 40% energy saving for green map SLE. And that means your building should, for me, to get there, and we'll go there later, is that you to do natural ventilation, to have hybrid cooling, to have very, very good efficient, highly efficient building system, and then to think about the air distribution in a proper way, and then to reduce everything that I could in my project, including at the adjustment of the internal temperature set point. Because to get to SLE, right, I think most of my projects are running somewhere around 25 is not even there. It's more like 26 degrees. And we'll talk about that later. Like what does this say, 25 degrees? I'm not sure like what is the temperature set point now? I think probably 25 in this room, you know. So 26 will be higher, and then it's getting higher and higher. So something to keep in mind. But then Singapore, you know, is along the way. It has like energy saving, all the measurements, all the verification is all along the way. So that's good. Then when you look at Indonesia, quite interesting. So Indonesia also has net zero program called Green Chip Net Zero, because Green Chip is a green mark of Indonesia. So for Green Chip, for me, what I find interesting beyond the topic of the energy and all of the on-site, off-site, is the aspect of health. So health and well-being is also part of what they're interested in. So that's what I think is interesting from the Indonesia side. Then comes UK. So I pick like the big one. So like in the Europe, right? Europe has been focused on energy for a long, long time. So this is not something new that they just come up with. Actually, even before I moved to Singapore, I think 5 years before that. So that must have been 2010 or like earlier than that. It's already been like a big focus on energy reduction and carbon emission reduction. So that's a big thing in the UK, like for a long, long time, you know. So they're quite far ahead in this. Most of the building over there, I think, is more stringent in terms of the energy reduction than Singapore. And US, so US recently launched the program LEED Zero that I'll cover a little bit more in detail. So for LEED, for US, I think if you ask me, it's more advanced in terms of the progression of how they think, right? But really do it, the implementation, I think Singapore is better in a way. Because US, they can lead the regulation and guidelines and the way of thinking, you know, and progression. But doing it, Singapore is better in doing that. And also verification, Singapore is much better. Because you can say that LEED building is performed like this, but Singapore, you need to go and measure the real thing, you know. In US, LEED is just still like a paper submission. So that's the main difference. So let's talk about LEED Zero a little bit. So LEED Zero, what does it mean? So LEED, if you don't know what LEED is, it's the green mark of US. So that's kind of a similar program, you know, touch upon sustainability benchmarking. But for LEED Zero to get here, you need to get a proper 4.0 in total. So that constitute of LEED Zero energy. So what that means is if you have your total energy delivery on site minus your non-renewable energy on site, it's in a way like you need to get zero energy from you. So if I have a house, my house needs to also produce same renewable energy. You know, if I have 100 unit, I need to produce 100 unit, right? And then I get zero. So that's kind of zero energy. Zero water is very interesting, and we'll touch upon zero water in a bit. that you will see is different. So in LEED, you need to first understand your potable water consumption, and that can be from like bathroom flushing, irrigation, cooling tower, you know, all of this that you can supply your water, right? And then in order to then get to the zero water, you need to use alternative water to reuse for that. Plus, you need to recharge on site. So what it means, if I have my house and then I have, I'm going to use the same unit, like 100 units of water, right, that I need to consume in-house, I can supply rainwater, maybe 50 of that unit. And then if it would have been somewhere else, not here, not in Singapore, like around the world, I have grey water or black water, you know, from the bathroom, right? I can treat it and reuse on site for another 50, then I get to zero, you know. So that's like zero, right? In the other way to look at it is, in a way, I'm not letting the water leaving from the project site at all. The key part here, I think, in terms of this whole tagline, is actually the water returned to the original source. So if I have some water left over, and the water left over would leave the site to go through the sewer for another treatment, then that's not zero water. Because that means the water leaves the site, and then it goes for like a centralized like city treatment or something. So that doesn't count. So in a way, I have to have within my own LEED boundary, the water I must consume and then recharge into the ground. So that's how the LEED water, the LEED zero water definition. The next one is zero waste. So this one will come back and do more detail later, but just to intro. So in a way, you just need to achieve platinum certification. Sounds easy, but the requirement in true zero waste, if you're interested in zero waste, and I know that the lecture prior to this session, right, was about waste management as well. I think like touch upon, probably not in detail, but true zero waste, I think for me, is the only one right now that has a lot of definition on how do you do or deal with waste management on site. Then you have the carbon. So carbon is quite simple, but carbon for LEED accounted two source, energy and transport. So this is the difference in LEED. So not only energy. So energy and transport must be zero, and that's how you declare zero carbon. So this is like all the four pillars. So you need to get these four pillars to get LEED zero. You can get one pillar. So if your project can get water, like I have my project that can get energy, can get water, can get waste, but not the carbon, you know. So you can get one of the three, but you cannot declare as LEED zero. That's all. But you can get one of the other as well. It doesn't mean that you need to get them all. Then come back to Singapore context, right, a little bit. This chart, we'll come back again later, but just to show you that there are two types of carbon that we're talking now, the operation carbon and the embodied carbon. So operation carbon is energy. So if you have anything to do with energy, you know, kilowatt hour, anything with the energy unit, energy operation, energy saving, that would be in the operation carbon. The embodied carbon actually is building material, you know, so like the building envelope, the interior fish out, the carpet and things that we have. So this is the embodied carbon that we have. Then in terms of operation carbon, just to show you the kind of the projection as well, the scary projection, if you ask me, is the column that I pick here, right, is kind of like, okay, now. And then if I have an office grade A, like, you know, a good office downtown Singapore, I would have an energy, you know, target of like 170 kilowatt hour meter square. So that's kind of the number, right? And you can see that from there, the projection as we go down, you know, it's like the next step down. And then the super low energy is even beyond that. So this is like a typical green mark, like platinum building, you know, or like gold plus platinum, I would get somewhere there. The super low energy, I think, is somewhere like a little bit lower, like 5 to 10% more than that, you know. So it's kind of like scary, like how do you move from what you can do to date, the best of you already, how do you move down from that scale? Then the term net zero really is not a new thing. So this was the magazine. This is probably the first time ever in Singapore that I've seen when they published the topic of net zero, and that's in 2018 was when they first published. And then when this magazine comes out, I love it. Why I love it is because it has lots of good diagram, you know, like this one, showing like really what do you mean by source energy, site energy, and then like energy cost saving, carbon saving, which I'll show you a little bit later, right? You can still look up this magazine and read it online. It's a really good version of it. So now comes the key terms and the tricks to remember them in a consultant way, I have to say. So this is what I like do every day, right? So people will be like, oh, I'm going to go for SLE. And then people will say, what is SLE? Super low energy. Then I need to explain, right? So super low energy building is actually the first step after platinum. So the current Green Map Platinum 2021, energy saving, you need to achieve 35%. So that's quite key. And then if you're going to achieve super low energy, it goes up a little. So from 35 to 40 is super low energy. There are two pathways to do it. The first one is to achieve the 40% from Singapore baseline. So that's one. The second one is if you know your like energy use way back then from this building typology in 2005. Sorry, that's a typo. That is supposed to be 2005, I think. You need to be better 60% than 2005 baseline. Sorry for the typo. So that's how you get your super low energy building. And super low energy building, you can have renewable on site. That's okay. Offsite must come from Singapore as well. Zero energy building is the next step. So zero is like it's say, right? 0 kilowatt hour. So that's quite simple. Again, I think the difficulty here in Singapore is you must do everything on site and then get the renewable from offsite from Singapore. So must purchase from Singapore. So if you look at the renewable certificate market, you know, of Singapore, it's quite interesting on the price. I think right now it's like in the 20 something unit, you know, sometimes it goes up and down. But if you look at offshore, it's like about 10 times lower than the Singapore on site, you know. So that's a economy to play there. Quite interesting in terms of the RECs market in Singapore. And then eventually, if you have a small enough building to get to the positive building, so this one similarly, but you need to be 115%. Meaning energy, you know, whether supply from on-site, off-site. So that's like the energy consumption supply, right, for the project. So this one it means that your building must produce more and get back to the grid. So if my building will use 100 units, I have my PV must be around 150, you know, that can supply. So this is the only one that you will feed something back to the grid. I personally haven't worked on any project that can do this. There's one project actually that I'll show you later that Sabana Jurong has worked on, and it does produce back, and I think you guys know it's SD4, right, in US building. So that one's produced more, and it's a zero energy building. So that's kind of the key definition to go for. And this chart I found, like I say, is 2005, sorry for the typo earlier. So this one is 2005, minimum energy saving compare. The difficulty from the consultant side here actually is to define the energy use intensity of 2005, because from my research, it doesn't, me personally, I haven't found anything that exists in 2005. I can find back to like maybe 2010. You know, so there's a table for 2010. I never found anything 2005. So that's a problem for me. So maybe if you guys can find it somehow. I'm sure BCA has it, but the data, you know, has not gone back like way back then, right? So most of the data that I can see is like either 10, 12, 10, 11, 12, 13. That one I can find a table from BCA. But beyond that, it's very difficult. But that's what BCA governing. So that somehow it does exist, and you need to ask your BCA officer, what is your baseline, you know? But for me to do the consulting, because I cannot keep asking BCA. So the best that I use is like, you know, I use the bag, the to trace it, the bag that I could, which is I think around 2010, yeah. So then this one I draw, this one actually is from a project because we need to explain to the client, right, on the net zero. So like I explained earlier that for the net zero energy to get to the 0 kilowatt, so this one you can either do it on site, which on my project, most of my projects are big, which is difficult, right? So we need to get from offsite somewhere in Singapore. And I think now, I think you heard also on like floating PV and things from PUV, so that's another source. But just so you know, it's also got bought up quite quickly in terms of people, you know, to sign up that I'm going to take the energy from that floating PV also, you know. So it's quite difficult to get offsite energy. Then the other one is net zero carbon. So offsite energy can come, but then if you want to get the net zero carbon, the offsite must come from like 100% renewable, right? So that's like offsite energy, because sometimes offsite energy can be other source if it's in another country. But in this case, if you want to get to the carbon zero, then it must be all renewable. So that's like how to get it. Then a lot of definition, actually. So it's quite important if you get in the consulting world or like if you get on a project to do this net zero. The first thing to ask is which country, what definition, and then you can even establish your own definition, to be honest. Because most of my project, right, like I told you, make positive influence. And my project are not easy. My project is always challenging and have different condition that is not normal. It's not like a typical commercial office. It would be something that is like I need to establish my own water boundary, my own energy boundary, you know. So feel free to do so. If you need to establish your own definition, it's okay as long as you follow the guideline and you have some guideline to follow. But this one is just to show you like that different country and different organization has different way of approaching this net zero definition, just to show you. And then just to conclude on this just a little bit, because people are always confused on this one, right? If it is on site, so imagine your own house, if it is within your own house, that's called the site energy, right? So within your own house. If it is your own house and then I have sink power supply, that is source energy. So something plugged in. So not shown here, but it's called source. So site energy is on site and then you have the source. And then the other term that people confuse the most is energy cost. The energy cost is when you get zero on your bill. So if you get like zero energy on your electricity bill, that has to do with that is energy cost. And then the one that is the most difficult one is the greenhouse gas emission on carbon. This one is very important to ask a client actually on like, you probably know about this, right? Scope 1, scope 2, scope 3. So you need to really think about like, what are you covering? You know, scope 1 mostly is like on-site energy. Scope 2 has to do with like seeing power too. Scope 3 can be like some other influence. Like tenants, you know, and other operation that comes into play. So something to keep in mind. But the most difficult one is always the carbon one that I find. And I always ask, like, do you want me to do it just energy or energy and water, energy, water, and waste, you know? So all of these, like, comes into play now. So it's all about defining the boundary. That's very important. Then are there any building courses, two that I think are more well-known is the BCA building one that I think you guys know. So inside, right, there are like the strategy that you need to get there. But the funny part about this one, and I think also all of the high-performance building, right, it's about how do you make it comfortable? How do you make it livable? How do you make it so that it's a space that you can go and enjoy, you know, being there? We try to, I think, raise the bar of the indoor temperature. And that is something that, do we know, is it right? We just kind of raise the bar because we need to get higher energy saving, right? So I can see from 25 degree, 26 degree in indoor temperature to now 27 is a new thing, you know? So eventually everyone will be like, 27, and we're going to have fans, and then it's going to be okay. Is it going to be okay? We don't know yet, but we are trying. That 27 will be okay. and you will save energy that way, you know. So it's kind of like one of those things, right? So of course, SDE4, and this is the number. If you're curious, so actually they are actually making net, right? Because they're producing more on site than they actually use during the operation. So that's kind of the EUI is 55. So if you look at the earlier charge that I show you is half of that eventually in 2025 like target, right? So this is like one of the good building. Also achieve the other certification, International Living Future. So this one is a Living Building Challenge. And this one is actually very, very difficult to get. So this one, in order to get this certification, you need to operate for 12 months and then confirm that, yes, your energy consumption is this much, you produce this much, and then they will check it. So this one is the most difficult one. It's not just like I'm declaring on my energy model, you know, that I achieve 100-something%, you know. So they actually measure it. So this one's very, very good building and very, very challenging to get. So this is kind of like the fact. It has like hybrid cooling, as you know, and then also achieve WELL certification. So if you're interested in health and well-being, it's also one of the good ones because they use the latest version, version 2. I'm a WELL faculty and WELL advisor, actually. So that's how I know all of this because I need to like keep track, right, of all the updates. Then come this, just for fun, yeah? So like I told you, 25, 26, 27, right? So 25 used to be like tagline, you know, you see like 25, aircon, very good. And then comes all the hybrid cooling, and 26 become the good thing, right? And now I see that the next big thing is actually 27. But when I say the term 27 in your brain, I'm pretty sure the color you see is orange, right? I mean, not orange, but like it's hot. It's not cold. It's like too high. It's too warm. How am I going to live? Kind of thing, right? It's just perception. If I make the color green, all of a sudden your mindset changes rapidly that it's okay. I can accept it. So I think it's just us, actually, you know, think about, is it really thermally comfortable? I think for us, Asia, the temperature is not so much of a problem. It's actually the wind, you know, and airflow through us. That's what we will feel more comfortable, right? Like last night, like I told you, I was walking with all of these like European and American, you know, people, right? And I'm the only one, and I'm Thai. So then, like, I walk, I'm like, oh, I'm fine. It's like, it's really a nice night. It's 20, I think it's 28, 29. And I'm like, oh, it's so cold, you know, and I walk around Gardens by the Bay, and the rest is like, oh my God, this is so hot, and I'm like, what are you talking about, this is already cold, so it's kind of your perception, and also the adjustment of the body to the environment that you're in, but for you guys, the next number you need to know is 27, definitely coming, already like in progress, so that's kind of like the next number. We're going up for probably eventually we don't need aircon anymore, which is like going to be all natural vent, you know. Yeah, and I think the other one on energy is to touch upon a little bit is waste to energy. It's a big thing in Singapore and definitely upcoming. Gardens by the Bay already have this for biomass in terms of waste to energy supply, right? So basically you have lots of waste. What do you do with it? So two things you can generate with waste if you have the waste to energy plan is you can either generate heat or electricity. So these are the two that you can do, depends on the application that you're going to do at site. I raised this because it's upcoming in Singapore, but then it goes against so much of the subject of net zero waste, which you will see later. So keep this in mind, waste to energy is definitely upcoming. Then of course, like, you know, how are we going to get positive? If you get to work on a project, right, that the client declare, I want to be a positive energy building, like, embrace it. Like, your project, if you have your project, I challenge you, like, and this is a good opportunity in class, you know, during the studio, you can do it. Because you're not building it for real yet. You can still, you know, how am I going to get there? So it's a good challenge, you know, to set up. Like, I want to be a positive building. And if you need help, I don't mind helping you. You can come after the lecture and get my contact, you know, and we can talk about it, you know, how to make your building to be a net positive. I don't mind helping at all. So that's like the next thing. Then just a little bit over, you know, onto other stuff like water. Water is really short because water Singapore covers so much. So net zero water, what does it mean in regards to Singapore? So for Singapore, the regulation is on site you collect storm water, and then you can treat and reuse on site, not a problem. But if you have gray and black water, right, you need to send through a centralized plant to treat, which is a new water plant. And then it will come back as non-potable, as you call new water. Overseas, they will call it either gray water or non-potable water. So these are the two terms that we'll use overseas. Then, I think you notice, one of the things that I find Singapore very interesting is you guys can sing the four source of water, you know, and then your water go, like, since when you're in the kindergarten. Other country cannot. So this is something that I really cherish from Singapore. So, of course, water is very important and limited in supply for you. So that's very important. And then the only one that I think in my definition, in terms of the certification, that is the most difficult one is a living building challenge, like I mentioned to you before. So living building challenge for the water, it used to be, that they allow you to collect your rainwater, and then you must, top up and reuse on site. That's it. In terms of the anything that has to do with health and safety, like something that you shower, the faucet, right, that one can come as potable water, not a problem. So that used to be the definition. So there's actually getting better at it because they know that it's tough. So now they only ask for 50%, reduction in non-potable water. But then you can be a net positive. So net positive will be in the same way that I explained to you before, that you really... really use all like non-potable water on site. But there's a definition for Atelier 10. So this one, we established it because there was just so many zero and so many definition of water. So at the end, we ended up with this term, zero water waste. So what does it mean, zero water waste? Zero water waste for us, it means that we collect the rainwater or gray water or black water. So this one is international, not local, but locally here. Just to emphasize, you can only use rainwater, that's it. But international, anything that is non-potable water that I can collect and treat and reuse, I would consider it. So I would use that, right, to top up all of my non-potable water demand, such as irrigation, cooling tower, the flushing, you know. So all of these are like non-potable water demand. And when I top it up all the way to 100, then I can declare my project as zero water waste. So that's I think this one is the Atelier 10 term. You can Google it. You will see one of the website that has it, and we have all the all the explanation there. But this is one of the one that we feel it's clear, it's clean to declare for project, because otherwise it's very convoluted how you declare the zero water. Then, of course, just to touch upon a little bit, now come the intertangle of agency of Singapore, right? So PUB is supposed to be about water and your water saving and things, but PUB now, as you know, also get into the production of the energy by putting floating PV in the reservoir. We are actually the consultant that work on this project at the beginning. The concern that PUB has, they have a good concern because they want to make sure that whatever that they do, right, doesn't affect the environment. So they hire us to do, I think it was almost a year and a half long of research and tracking, and we put lots of sensor specifically underneath and right above the PV to make sure that the temperature, underneath the PV in the water, yeah, not just underneath, but in the water, underneath the PV, and then on top of the PV, all of this will not affect the biodiversity, within the reservoir area. So it was quite a long process to went through, and we also did computational fluid dynamic. I heard that some of you also use, like, Fluent, right, to run your study. But this one we use... the open form one because it's more complicated. Fluent will not work on this one, sadly. You need to be on the code side. So it's an open form computational fluid dynamic that's more advanced. To kind of match, you know, and verify through the simulation. So it's quite interesting, the whole process. And then at the end, it was okay. It won't affect the biodiversity. So the project, you know, get ongoing. And that's why you have your floating PV. This was about, I think like 3 years ago was when it was started, you know. So it's quite like all of this project, like I get to see 3 to 5 years before the project is done, right? So all that you know is, yes, it's there. But it's a long process to get there, lots of simulation to get it there. So this one, I'm just tying it because you can see the holistic view of Singapore agency. So now the water agency also get into the energy production business, you know? So very interesting, right? Zero waste is a new thing. And the thing that people doesn't talk a lot in the project, sadly, but it's very important because you generate lots of waste throughout the day. I have to say for this presentation, because True Zero Waste has so good in terms of the slide that they have. So I use a lot actually from them today. So the content of Zero Waste is how to get to zero. But Zero Waste is not really zero. Zero Waste is actually today worth 90% of your waste from landfill and incineration. So I use the term incineration. So anything burned, like waste to energy, doesn't consider for zero waste. So if you do waste to energy, that's like a no-no, a big no for zero waste. The reason, and I asked them, like, why Singapore do this all the time? Zero waste is so normal. And then, not zero waste, waste to energy is quite a thing, and we need it because we have limited resource. The answer, oops. Hello? Yes. The answer that I got from the zero waste people through zero waste is that they consider raw material quite important. Once you burn it, it's done. You know, so you need to start again the process, right? So that's why they believe that in order for them to conserve the resources, you do not burn. So that's like one thing. So burning is not okay for true zero waste. But this is like the definition, you know. So managing your resources. For us, I try as a fund in my Bangkok office for like a month. It's still ongoing. It's quite interesting, and I challenge you all to do the same. Imagine from the beginning of the day until the end of the day, you have one trash can only in a house. And then you try to then weigh how much trash going out from your house every day. And then you will start to realize like how difficult it is and how wasteful you are, right? So every day in my 10 office people in Bangkok, and we try our best, the weight going out is still around half a kilo. Or food waste mainly, about 80% is food waste. The funny part was then it's starting, you know, to save them some money over lunch because some people over order. So now they're starting to order just what enough to eat, you know. So food waste is also a big part of Singapore. It's a lot of waste going out. So that's something that you can do right at home starting today. Then I think the concept, and you know the 3R, this is not like fancy, but I think through Zero Waste, they brought in two others that I think is quite interesting, and it's quite fit SUTD, it's redesigned. So imagine if you have a building that, you know, can use regular, like, I don't know, like steel, you know, a piece of steel to make it, like maybe I cut it in half, right? Versus something that I cut and then the length just doesn't work. I need like two extra pieces. So that comes like waste that you need to deal with. And it also comes with the embodied carbon that you need to deal with, you know. So eventually, as we go along the process of this like net zero, less waste, less energy, less carbon, less material, less cost, very important for the client, you will need to redesign. So something to think in mind to keep in mind that's very important. Re-earth is more on landscape, which I think fits Singapore as well. Like seascaping, you know, to do like plants that are like native vegetation and things. So this is like good for the re-earth. And then like I say, to be a true zero waste, right? Or net zero, you need to make sure that you discard from you have zero discard to landfill and incineration. So this is important. But the ratio is a little bit different. So they only ask for up to 90%. So anything greater than 90 is already good. You don't need to hit 100. So that's one key. But you might think, okay, 90, easy. Not really. 90 is very difficult to get. Even to get in Singapore beyond 60 is already difficult. Whenever that I'm working on not green mark project, but lead project, I have to track my construction waste, right? And now it's even beyond more stringent that I cannot allow the contractor to just say that, oh, I'm just going to take this trimming and that concrete and I'm going to landfill it for like something on the side or like somewhere in Singapore. I cannot do that anymore. It used to be okay for like road pavement top up, but not okay anymore. So that's make it more difficult. So this one is the rate that you need to remember. And no waste to energy, no incineration. That's very important. And then come this one. So if you can reuse anything, really, it's good. Or think about anything that you can make, give it a second life. It's always lower your overall embodied carbon. We actually work with, I'm not going to name the name, one of the very big building here in Singapore. And then they were thinking of to replace the facade. And we actually work with them to, you know, really make them to come to realization that if you're going to replace all your facade, which is the glass, and glass has lots of embodied carbon, you know, so can you do something else? Because glass can last for a while and that reduce your embodied carbon too. So at the end, you know, they'll keep the glass and do something else. So that's good. That's already lower a lot of carbon footprint. Right there. And then, of course, like, you know, the other one is to do the right thing. And I find that this subject of waste and to reduce waste is very challenging in Singapore when I talk to the client now. So if you are interested, it is another new thing that's upcoming that you should think about. And then not the last, but before last, is that embodied carbon. So embodied carbon has to do with material, right? So like I mentioned earlier, operation carbon is about energy. Embodied carbon is about material management in a way. And what material do you bring into the site? You need what? To build building, concrete, steel, you know, glass, right? The main one for your structure. And then all the fit out that you have here. So all of this actually surrounding us has carbon footprint that we need to think about. And then in terms of the lifetime, I think like you can. There's actually one more chart that's more interesting. So this one is more just to focusing on the reduction, you know, of the embodied carbon as we go along to 2050. And then Atelier has been doing this like for so long, right? 30 years in the making. And the Gardens by the Bay is among, I think, the first project here, because when we first work on this project, all they care is they say they want a carbon neutral project. You know, so how do we achieve it? If you don't know, is basically we have, and this one actually comes later. So normally, the biodomes run with the chiller plan, right? And then when we talk to actually in park, that's when we learn that you have a lot of wood chips coming from the tree clippings per day. So we use that as a resources in the biomass boiler, you know, that then runs the absorption chiller. So we have absorption chiller and an electric chiller to feed the chill water into the domes. And then the byproduct of that is the fertilizer that we use inside the garden. So it's kind of like you can see the full cycle. So you have cycle of air, cycle of water, cycle of waste, you know, happening at Gardens by the Bay. So this is among like the first, like, you know, full holistic view in terms of the carbon for us. As we go along, this is a project that we're working on with the WWF headquarters. So this one, actually the part that I just want to mention is on the embodied carbon that we did an extensive calculation. And to calculate embodied carbon is like to calculate your energy use in a building. So you need to know all the components. And now more than ever, it's easier with Revit, thank God, because you can do the calculation of the volume, you know, of your geometry and things, you know, much faster than before. So when we know that volume, we can actually do the calculation of the embodied carbon actually easily. So this one, we save around 4,000 tons of carbon, you know, compared to a reference building. So that's one of the big thing that we do. But just the other one is, if you know Barangaroo in Sydney, is also a carbon positive neighborhood that we're involved with. And then this one to show you, right, it's quite interesting, this one. When I first looked at this, I was like, nothing much changed. But if you really look at it, this is the operation energy, you know, over the course of 60 years. And then this one, by 2030, right, you can see the pie chart is getting from 70 to 40. Since that the building energy is very efficient, which is true, because we're getting there, right? Super low energy, zero building energy and all, right? So that's getting better. So now the difficult part is actually, as this pie chart gets smaller, the other chart that will come in place is your embody. So that's why embody carbon is quite a big thing. And if within the next 5 years, it will be like a lot of topic about it, you know? And if you think like, oh, I just do the carbon calculation. So if you really look at it, you have to look at the wall, the enclosure, the facade, all the glazing, everything in there is a lot of calculation. The complication of this study is as extensive as energy model. It takes about 2 to 3 weeks to get it done, just so you know. And then circular economy is another topic, meaning that, like I say, we use everything as much as possible. And then this one I just show in terms of the carbon saving, right? So if you have like a code compliance building versus, you know, you reuse some of the building, right? So you can save it right there. And then some sustainable renovation during the material and things, right? During the design, so you can save even more. So for your project, even if you talk a little bit about embodied carbon, you know, in your master thesis and things, that's already good, because when you show your portfolio, you know, after you graduate, then your employer will be like, oh, actually, they think about it, you know, they study in class, so you understand this topic. So I highly encourage that if you have a little bit of piece of embodied carbon in your project, that would be really great. Just to show you also, like, people think a lot now in terms of reuse, because if you really think about it, there's a lot of existing building fabric in Singapore as well, right? More than new building going up. But I think Singapore is going fast, and the way we demolish is also fast. I have to say, like, they just like, whoop, and within 2 weeks, you know, the building is gone into construction, just like magic. But then a lot of embodied carbon, you know, happened there, because you demolish a lot of things. So now I can see a little bit of a hybrid where some developer might be like, I want to keep the structure, but then I want to renovate the facade, you know, so make the facade more, much better, and also a building system. So that's like things that's happened. So this is like two projects that you can see, two different things, whether you keep or like you demolish or not. But like this one I just show, right? Not to complicate you guys, but just to show you how difficult and the complexity to do this type of calculation. So we really need to understand the volume from like substructure, superstructure. Substructure is basically underground. Superstructure is when you come above ground. And then enclosure, building envelope, you know, and interior. So we always divide it like this. And then we have to understand the volume and then talk to the client, like, do you use this concrete mix or another concrete mix? What kind of embodied carbon is within the mix, you know? So this will be, right now it's like alien to you, but I'm telling you, in 2 to 3 years, when you really come out to the market, it'll be the norm. Everyone's gonna talk about this, like your mix will be this and that, and that's why you lower your embodied carbon. Right now it's really difficult to get data in the mainstream. So this is kind of like the chart, like another fun one that we do, because we're very good at graphic, as you can tell. So this is another one that we would do, is we would separate and show them, like, in terms of a building, right? How much concrete do you use? So we would look at the main type of material first, because then we attack, you know, in terms of like how to reduce the overall embodied carbon in the right way. So different building has, I think in Singapore mostly is concrete. Rarely that I would see like a good, like, proper steel, you know, structure. There are, but you start with lots of concrete first. So that's why I think this one fit. And then, of course, you know, then you ask, like, what is then the baseline, right? And then the best practice and the aspirational. I think this one is very difficult to get now, because then you need to be, like, timber structure is very low in body carbon, but then you have lots of problem, right, in Singapore, such as the humidity, termites and things. So probably not okay to do timber. So you need to find an alternative, like I say, low in body carbon material. And then eventually, like going back to the chart that I show at the beginning, so you have like your building envelope, the building system, the on-site renewable, you know, and then how do you then offset from here? So some people actually do a lot of sequestration through, like you can do, like I say, timber. But timber, very difficult in Singapore. And then you need to look at the lifespan as well of the material and then how it comes on site. Singapore, again, a lot of everything, not a lot, but everything is import. So that's why it's really difficult to define this, you know, embodied carbon and really defend that, yes, it is sustainable, you know, and things. Because you need to bring everything to Singapore. So transport is one of the embodied carbon part. So that's quite difficult. And then you can do a lot. This one I do a lot on my project because Singapore grows lots of trees. So landscape replacement and trees can reduce carbon footprint. So you can do that. And then of course like the haze and thing, right? That's why I bring it. So this is kind of things that you need to know. So we touch upon like energy, water, waste, and then embodied carbon. So now let's look forward because we need to be beyond, right? And I'm happy that I did add in this section for the lecture. It's like what is upcoming? What is your future? You know, that's immediate upcoming. So we know this, we are sustainable, fine. The other term that I heard a lot, we are resilient, right? Singapore is very resilient. So what is resilient really? Resilient to me is like if something happens, like there's a blackout or like some earthquake or something, so you drop and then you can come back right away. So that's resilient, right? But then the next one that you're going to see in terms of the upcoming trend is regen. So regenerative is like beyond. So regenerative is like a combination of resilient and then continue to be better. And this one is the tough target, you know. If you're going to go beyond zero, then regen is like the thing that you need to get into. So when you get into regen, quite interesting is that resilient, when you talk about it, is about like I say, you have a problem, you have a disaster, and then you drop, right? So it's a problem. So you need to deal with your problems. Regeneration is actually about potential. So what can the project be? It looks for like the positive outcome, the holistic whole system thinking. So that's regen, you know? So that this is kind of like where we are, I think it's like more like almost here, you know, and then we're trying to kind of go like in this path projection, right? Most of my project now, I think most of them are actually here, kind of like I want to be net zero, I want to be just balanced with nature and everything, right? But some project, they're really thinking on some aspect in terms of regenerative design. So they're actually pushing more toward like this end of the chart now. So that's the next thing if you want to get into. The interesting part, this one I learned about regen was, then I was like, but I'm going to make more chilled water than what I can consume, right? Then the client will automatically ask, can I sell chilled water to my neighbor? Like, can the neighbor project, like, you know, take this chilled water? The answer is yes, but you need to work with them, you know, somehow. But that's kind of the upcoming thing that they're thinking of sharing all of this infrastructure, you know, in a large scale. So district cooling definitely is already in, you know, in the market and things. But in terms of commercial district cooling, you know, in terms of Singapore moving forward, it's going to be more of this. And then sharing, in terms of sharing economy, is something. So this is why the boundary, you need to understand the definition of the boundary and then think about how you can share. Then your term of this like net zero and things, right? It's kind of like getting more interesting of how do you share, how do you do accounting and things. And this one I just draw because there are like four pillars in here. It's about environment. So like this is like where we are in terms of all the things that we know in terms of the environment. But where we can be, you know, we can be a better net zero carbon, positive climates and things. So this is like no emission, no waste. So this one is like regenerative thinking. And then the other one is on the community side, right? How to go, you know, from cradle to cradle to circular economies and things. So this one is like, if you want, this one is a good summary for you in the slide I'll share. So this one was a long, hard work actually to summarize like all the regenerative strategy that we can be. And then in terms of the culture in this case is not like Singapore culture, but rather like Aki culture, you know, and all the culture that we have on how to become more, be part of the nature, you know, support and things. And then lifestyle is the last one, right? Connection to be more smart in terms of the data, also like sharing data and things, social connection and health. So this is like the four pillars that I see that are coming in terms of the region that you need to know. So for us, I think to end the lecture, right? I was trying to kind of find like, how do I end the lecture after like, you know, talking so much about like lots and lots of topic is actually, I think it was last month, like about 2 or 3 weeks ago, I went out with Lee Siang. Actually, he was at that lunch with me. And we had lunch with LTA. I think it was LTA, NEA, and then BCA, you know. To me, when I went for that lunch, I was like, okay, the topic was that, okay, let's get together after COVID. Let's talk together, you know, on what we can do, right? And then learn about each other. And I find actually when I come out from the lunch was quite like, I learned something, you know, from that small 1 hour lunch. So like the authority, like LTA, they're also thinking on regenerative, already in advance, actually. They already take the energy from, you know, your train, right? When you push the brake into the station. So they would transfer that energy back into the station to supply. So that's already like regen. And then NEA was quite interesting. So the NEA was talking to us that during COVID, lots of waste was generated. And they actually, you know, have done is segregated their waste, you know. So apparently NEA, to me now, has lots of supply because NEA has, I have this pile of this material and this material and this material. You just need to let me know what you need, you know. So NEA apparently is a good material supply locally. So they have that. So that was good, right? So it's quite interesting to see, like, all of the agency. The other one we were talking about for LTA was, we were talking on the floating PV, right? That we we would do the renewable with PV. So LTA, I then asked LTA, you have lots of road, you have expressway, and it's quite long. Imagine if you put like little PV cell, you know, along the middle of the road, all the way across Singapore, right? Imagine how much energy generation you can do. But I think that the question mark that we have there is more on. To be like LTA is not a power generation. LTA is not seeing power, you know. So you need to kind of think of the boundary of where you go, right? But it's possible because they have area, they have the potential, they have all the opportunity to generate lots of energy for Singapore to use, right? So that's kind of when I think like all of the agency in Singapore, they can crisscross and talk to each other and supply each other, you know, in terms of all of this holistic management. So one single lunch, right? I actually came out and I was like, I have a whole new view of like, oh, actually NEA is not just, you know, this and that, you know. So I really think of like Singapore helping each other, all the agency helping each other to get, you know, to the beyond zero, to where you're going to go. So I think that's all I have for today, just to end with, you know, a small quote that, you know, we need to do it together. To get there. And then I hope that you learn something about net zero. At the least, make sure you learn energy, waste, water, and carbon, some definition out from today that you can use for your, you know, your class and also when you get into the real profession. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Anyone taking the design toward carbon neutral this semester? Supposed to run this semester, is it? No one? Oh, no, not running on this semester? Oh, it's running. So who's in that class? Two, three, four, five. You should learn something today, right? You can use in your class. No questions, really? That's a prize. Very good question. And I this one, the one project, I'm going to use a project, right, to kind of back it up, because I think it's a good project to back it up as well, is Mandai Zoo. So the reason why I picked Mandai Zoo was when I first worked on the project, it's not that they don't allow us to use any renewable, but they were worried about the microclimate. Especially, you know, at Mandai, imagine you have lots of trees, you know, there, right? And it's quite natural reserve area. And to put PV there, any PV, cooling tower, and this would affect the biodiversity, you know? And they were also thinking about if the animal, I'm not sure whether it's going to get that hot, like let's say a squirrel run over, you know, the PV and touch and like hot, and then somehow die or something, which probably not going to happen, you know. But they think about it, right? That means they care, and I appreciate it so much. So at the beginning, it was quite a touchy subject to do that. But at the end, and all of this is, yes, PV, you know, is black. So it's like a black body, you know, so it will absorb the energy, right? But I think if you do it, and the floating PV is another good project of an example that we really study the microclimate, that yes, it does raise, but it won't change your microclimate, like habitat, that much. And the other question I got a lot is glare, in terms of if you look down from, like, you know, HDB to the PV that are like low rise, right? Would there be any effects? Not really as well, because it's black. I mean, yes, it's glass, but it's not as bad as like a reflected glass vertical, I have to say. Yeah. So I think at the end, and there's also more new technology of PV now that look like terracotta tiles. We are trying right now with some shop house design, you know, with this new type of tiles that are more like light color. It's not as efficient as the black one, but still, you know, it does generate some energy. And Tesla, of course, always come up with something quite interesting in terms of their product. I think the last point I want to make is integrated building, building integrated PV, right? BIPV. So that's like a color PV on the facade. It's also like, I'm going to be honest, it's not as efficient as the monolithic PV, you know, flat at the roof. But because some building does have a lot of vertical, like I'm working on another project that, interesting enough, my worry is not about glass, because most of the building is solid, but the building is with a white, not like white to gray color, you know, but it's a lot of surface that if I mount it and make the skin to generate energy, that would be good for the project. So it's kind of experimental one that we're thinking of, right? But I think PV is getting more interesting, and just think beyond the box, beyond just the normal one that you have, and you will see more opportunity. There are colored ones, there are see-through ones as well, and there are one that looks like I told you, like if you are working on like a chop house, like a terracotta tiles color. So it's a lot of things that, so imagine, right, from a house, a typical house that is just a normal terracotta roof and things, all of a sudden you generate energy on top of the roof. And that's how you're going to get to your net zero. Yeah. No question on water? Yes. Oh. Yeah, that's a good question actually, for all. And I know that some of you are more designer, because I teach you guys before, right? You're your previous alumni anyway. Some of you are architect, you're very good designer. Some of you might question yourself, like, because SUTD, one good thing about SUTD that I love is that SUTD also teach you and arm you with simulation capability. And that's great. Because when you go out in the industry, even if, yes, what you're doing, it's kind of like, for us, it's more like, it's nothing. Like, basically, if you come to work for Atelier 10 and I have a SUTD student, I retrain you. But the retrain is easier because it's like, you know, you drive a car, you know how to drive, right? But if I ask you, can you drive a Ferrari? It's a different thing. So it's more like, yes, you know how to drive a car, but I give you like a very powerful simulation tool. That is more advanced, right? So I need to teach you how to use that tool properly. But to get to your point, the normal way, I think I'm an architect by training, like I told you, and I tend to, when I consult, get into the design side a little bit more. So think with the designer. Sometimes the designer will think, but then they cannot think the way that I think, because I can see that. Or if you use the system, if it's a displacement ventilation, you know, or like in this room, like underfloor displacement, for instance, along the step, you know, it would save more energy and things, right? So these are the things that we need to talk to them. But then the question comes, I'm not an engineer. I don't have, and don't worry about it. It's not a problem. That's why there's MEP engineers on you know, in the project. So you need to know your limits, but then you need to push them sometimes, because if you don't push them, most of the time they'll be like, oh, it's an auditorium, I'm going to put in VAV. And then if I go in, I'm like, actually, can you do underfloor displacement, or like, you know, the displacement along the step, you know, which is more efficient. You need to push them, because otherwise the MEP will come in and just put in a traditional. So it's one of those things where you're starting to learn like what is efficient, but in terms of the technical ability, this engineer to support you. You're never going to work in a project now in Singapore that there's only architect. Most of the project that you work with will have architect, engineer, civil engineer, landscape. This is like my normal everyday, yeah? One big room. And then sometime also acoustic, lighting, who else? Facade, ABC water specialist, you know, horticulturist. These are like people, you know, that will get involved in your one little project, no matter what, most of the time. Definitely basic is architect, engineer, ESD, landscape. So this is like a given, right? Lighting designer. And then the rest are kind of like add-on as you go along. Yeah, you went as an architect, also you will ask lots of questions because you won't know. Oh, structural engineer is another one. Because you're in transport, because you won't know so much. But you will have the team. It's called MDT. MDT stands for multidisciplinary team. This is a new term as well that came out, I think, from Mandai project. And then afterward, all the government in Singapore use this term. MDT. It's an MDT team, multidisciplinary team, to work in the project. Yeah. So you get like me. In-house at Atelier 10, we have a mixture of people. Some are like research-based. Some are building technology based. Some are architects like me. I'm an architect and building technologist, right? And material specialist. I have my business partner who's an engineer. So he takes care of all the energy, computational fluid dynamic, right? We got another staff, like I told you, from San Francisco, who got a master in building technology from Berkeley. And then she became a specialist in embodied carbon. You know, so it's like a team. Even inside the company, we have expert within the team, you know, to support each other. I hope that answers your question. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, so the question is about, let me repeat, and you nod, yeah, if I hear you, because it's quite low here, the volume. Embodied carbon and timber, right? That's a question, nod, yes? Okay. Yeah, because if you think about it, timber, to harvest timber, to produce timber, is definitely, it requires, you just need to grow the trees and cut the trees down, right? And you can grow the tree sustainably as well with like FSC wood and things, you know, so sustainable forest. So this one is considered like low embodied, you know, material. Wood is definitely low embodied. But in Singapore, what do you have? Humidity, you know, and termites. So it's quite difficult to just do wooden construction here. Straight, and then also longevity is another one, you know, to think about in terms of in my project right now. If I ask you, the only client that I can think that they are like, when I say this, they don't have problem, is Microsoft, because Microsoft themselves is very into carbon footprint calculated, so they want to get into the net zero carbon, right? So they really think about all of their operation and things. But the difference is because Microsoft, it depends on the country as well. Like in the US, they have lots of land. So like their main campus, they can actually have like a PV farm next door, you know. But then all of their construction, they do consider a wood construction. But then it depends on the climate. But the climate where we are, wood is quite difficult, you know, to last long. In a humid with all the termites that you have. So something to think about. Can you do it? Yes, you can. You can have, and I really look forward if I have a project that I can do wooden construction in Singapore, that would be nice, you know. But I would say the proportion of material that is wood would probably be more like the decorated part, you know, on the skin, but not really like the core structure. So I wouldn't, unless it's a really, really small building in Singapore, which I think can happen. It can happen, and it is a good thing, but it is a challenge just because of the climate that you have. That's all. Yep, MKPL. Yeah, I think like project, I think there's many angle, and I've come across many way, you know, to approach a project. So there's no one way that is the right way. It's just what is the right for your project, right? So if the client has come to me, and I'm picking your example, if the clients come and like, I want to have a wooden finish, you know, building, then as a consultant, you need to deliver it, because that's a client goal, right? But the question is more to really make sure it's longevity, that it lasts, you know, that it's just not like coming up for 10 years and then, you know, it's gone already. So that's not good. So for us, I think, and that's why in the new green map, there's a new section called maintainability, which I think is quite interesting. So the maintainability session, you know, talks about all of this, like, you know, the long lasting construction, right, of Singapore. And now if you work on the government project in particular, it's quite, I mean, I used to be okay, I have good design, very, you know, nice design is enough, right? But now I really need to think, is it constructible, is it, I'm sure you come across this word, constructability. Like, is it easy to construct? Is it like too complicated to construct? You know, so most of you, I'm telling, like, because I know student, you come up with quite an interesting design. Most of the time, which is quite difficult to construct. and the cost is an issue, you know. So when you go into the real industry, right, all of this net zero, if you think about it, it's a two-way street. You save all of this energy, water, carbon, material, and body carbon, right? Why? Because then at the end, sometime you need to buy more things like better building system to save your energy, or sometime you spend less on your material, right? So you have zero waste kind of thing, you know? So it's a balancing act. But at the end, there will be a number you need to work by. There will be like $300 million. That's it. No more than that. And then everything will be like value engineering cut all the way. I think I spend more time in value engineering more than the design itself, which is quite good. It gets you to be a good consultant. You really think about, like, you will be amazed at the end of the value engineering that you can achieve the same, not the same, but like, you know, almost the same of what you want with less, you know, less money going in. Yeah. Yes. 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 You have to balance. There's no right or some building. I would argue that it's better to demolish. I agree on that statement as well. But it depends on building. So you need to do the assessment first. You know whether demolish is a better way to save the carbon than refurbish it. You know, or renovate the building. I actually work on one local shop house now that's going under the renovation as well. And yes, the topic does come up on, because you cannot touch so much, right, when it comes to shop house. You just need to maintain the exterior appearance. But what you can do is to think about the layer behind that exterior appearance, right? So because all that they ask is the facade needs to look the same. You know, they never tell me the inside, I cannot add another layer, right? So the facade, I need to keep the glass. Sometimes if I do need to do something inside as a second layer, then I would need to, just from the performance standpoint, right? Some building does that, if you really need to keep the existing facade. But if the facade does allow you to put in a better glazing, like most of the shop house has like a single glaze, right? And that's kind of the way it is. But if you need to have a high performance, you know, for your ETTV to be low, the envelope thermal transfer value to be low, question becomes when you calculate, because if it's a traditional like shop house or historic, then it's easy because your window to wall ratio is not that much. But if it's like a higher window to wall ratio, then that's a problem. So for me, it's more in to understand the context first. I would normally prefer to do at the facade as much as I could, but not changing the historical. So still follow, you know, whatever the historical allow, you know? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, to demolish and then reconstruct or keep it, right? Yeah, that one you need to do the balance factor. If it's like, and you can do this quite easily now. It's an just an exercise to go through. Like, if I demolish this, how much embodied energy, am I taking away from it? And then I need to reconstruct it again. Then what would that be, right? So it is quite simple. And then at the end, I don't have the. I'm going to be honest. I don't have a proper answer, because to me, what I would do is quite an extensive exercise. If the owner really want to keep the building structure, then I would think about it quite clearly that first, how long is this building? If it's just within the past 10 years, and probably not, because it's quite a new structure. But if it's like 30, 40 years, probably it's time. And then you will also have to deal with asbestos and things too inside sometimes. So that's like a bad thing to have for air quality. So it there's no right and wrong answer. I don't have a proper answer for that one, but it's more on to really do a proper exercise to assess on your overall carbon footprint and consumption before making decision. Some building are easy. Some building are like quite old, right? And you look at it and you're like, nah, it's gone. Some building like Funan is a good one, right? Some other within the past, like I think 10 to 20 years, is something to think about. Yeah. I think I recently was also involved in, I didn't work on it, I pitched about it, is Google. The building was also an existing building that they renovated, and then they, cut out some inside because Google loved the stair, and then they changed the facade a little bit. Yeah, so that one, they keep the existing building.